Last Friday, something uncharacteristic happened. The House passed a $733 billion defense spending bill with no Republican votes. If that sentence doesn't have you intrigued, then nothing will. This was all capital D Democrats voting to spend a ton of money on the military. Maybe they're just trying to make tanks less cool for Trump. Kinda like how me saying I like Straight Outta Compton immediately ruins all of its street cred. Instead, it became an incredibly bloody debate about the power of Congress in declaring wars, leading House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy to go on TV and say,
"I've seen a lot of things happen on this floor. I've seen a lot of things that embarrass me. But this is probably the one most shameful things I've ever seen a majority do."
Whoa, buddy, you must be new here. So what the heck happened? Well, I'm gonna have to go back to everybody's favorite schoolhouse rocker, the bill on Capitol Hill. On June 27th, about 3 weeks ago, depending on when you're watching this, the Senate passed a $750 billion defense bill, and it was incredibly nonpartisan. I mean, senators voted 86-8 on the National Defense Authorization Act. That somehow managed to do even better than the act that gave all senators and representatives pay raises. At least they know what they're worth. So once this incredibly uncontroversial defense spending bill was passed in the Senate, they slid it over to the House, expecting a pretty easy passage. Unfortunately, anything but happened, with the House adding some pretty controversial amendments and passing their amended version on party lines. In this episode, we're going to be talking about the differences between these bills and what's going to happen next. First though, what were the amendments? Well, interestingly enough, the news has not really latched onto this story at all, as I'm not sure if you've heard, but Trump tweeted something else super racist and covered two topics within a 24-hour news cycle. That's crazy talk. Because of this, I'm going to have to largely rely on Congress people speaking out about this in testimony. Now, there are a lot of substantial amendments to go through, so I'm going to have to rattle them off pretty fast.
This year, 439 amendments, a record, were made in order.
Yeah, those are a ton of amendments. So let's get to some of the major ones. First, California Democrat Barbara Lee's amendment to repeal the 2002 authorization for use of military force against Iraq. Now that might sound like a weird and very specific place to start, but that's huge. In 2002, Congress said America could go after Al-Qaeda and affiliated forces. And well, it turns out there just so happens to be a bunch of those forces in every country we want to influence. Those countries include military actions by America in the Philippines, Djibouti, Eritrea, Ethiopia, Georgia, Kenya, Libya, Somalia, Syria, Yemen, and most famously, Iraq. Now some in Trump's administration are saying, "You know, Iran probably has some Al-Qaeda members as well. Let's send our soldiers over there to fight terrorism. You don't think their government will mind this covert war going on in their borders, right?" Another amendment is that the House bill bans Defense Department facilities from housing any foreign national detained by U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement. Whew, boy, this warrants an episode of its own. But basically, while reducing the number of beds for people detained might sound like the opposite of a solution to overcrowded detention centers, the Democrats' plan is to force the president's hand to detain fewer people because we don't have space to put them all. Of course, if he doesn't change his mind on the condition of the southern border detention centers, this will probably end up making everything about the problem worse. They weren't willing to take that gamble a step further with unaccompanied minors though. As Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez's proposed amendment for this bill that would have banned the military from housing migrant children was rejected. Now this is partially because, unlike detained families or adults, it's a lot harder to look at an unaccompanied 7-year-old picked up at the border and say, "Congratulations, you're free to go now. Now get a job and show up in court at this date." Then there was Amendment 423, which, whoo boy, buckle up for this one.
It uses the power of the purse to preclude any use of force whatsoever against Iran unless it is previously authorized by Congress or provoked by an attack on the United States or our armed forces.
Now, this might surprise you, but that last guy was actually summarizing that bill in a way that was designed to make it sound like a bad idea. This amendment would make it so that no federal funds would be put towards an attack on Iran unless they attack us or both houses of Congress give Trump the thumbs up. Of course, the potential problem here is, if they attack one of our allies, that would not trigger the okay for the US to attack Iran. Next, and this one feels quite a bit passive-aggressive compared to the rest, but it would prohibit the president from holding military parades for political purposes. Gee, I wonder what that's in reference to. This one's a bit Mean Girls-esque, but getting back on track, transgender people, welcome back to the armed forces. Yeah, we're gonna err on the safe side and not make any jokes about this one. Talk about entering dangerous territory. Next, it would block the Defense Department from spending money at Trump properties, unless, of course, the president reimburses the government. Now, this is a weird one, because at first, I had no idea what this was really in reference to. But
another potential conflict of interest cropping up now. It turns out the Pentagon may be renting space at Trump Tower here in New York.
Yeah, turns out the Pentagon has spent $300,000 at Trump properties. Frankly, that's a much lower number than I was expecting. Now, this of course opens the question as to whether this money is a gift to the president or just renting out a hotel room at market value that happens to be owned by the president's family. Trump. This argument is currently going through the courts, but this amendment here says that the private company, the Trump Organization, needs to reimburse the Defense Department for the time they spend at his properties. You can probably count on this amendment showing up in the next season of Supreme Court Saturdays, if it somehow manages to pass the Senate. Next, it would ban support for and participation in the Saudi-led coalition's military actions in Yemen. Yeah, remember that ban that passed in the Senate, and then passed in the House, before getting vetoed by the president, which it could not recover from. Well, it's back, and this time, if the president wants to fund the troops, he can't veto this legislation. This is of course contingent on it passing the Senate. The last major amendment was that this would limit the administration's ability to transfer arms and sell arms to Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates without congressional support and approval. Of course, this was tacked on to a more than $700 billion spending and appropriations bill. So, military, maybe you can cut down on your side hustle a bit. Of course, the reason this is an issue here is that arming Saudi Arabia, well, some argue we shouldn't be arming them because the war in Yemen is unethical and leading to a humanitarian crisis. But others on the other side say that they're gonna get the weapons from Russia anyways if we don't sell it to them. Why not make a quick buck and deepen our diplomatic ties with this oil-rich country in the process? Now, one last major amendment is something that's definitely a throwback to the early 2000s. You know, a time when we were stabbing the heck out of our Capri Suns trying to get it into that little hole. A partisan problem was emerging in Cuba.
Democrats would close Gitmo, and against all common sense, bring some of the world's worst and most dangerous terrorists to the United States, instead of keeping them where they belong.
That's right, we might be shutting down G-Bay. Well, more accurately and less clickbaity, it's a ban on sending new prisoners to the Guantanamo Bay Detention Center. Alright, two more rapid fire. It includes a prohibition on deploying low-yield nuclear weapons, which, phew, I'm at the point of my life right now where a nuclear war would really interfere with my life goals. And it would also impose restrictions on how the Pentagon can transfer funds between its accounts. This would mean that the clever accounting that led to Trump's emergency declaration yielding money for the wall might be harder in the future. Alright, so those are the many, many, many amendments in this new legislation. Whoo-wee, let's just take a quick breath. Now it's time to get to what's next. The House of Representatives took this appropriations bill that was passed by the Senate and amended it from top to bottom, before passing their own amended version last Friday. Now comes the reconciliation period, where the Senate and the House leaders play a high-stakes game of spot the difference. They take a little bit from the Senate bill and a little bit from the House bill until they have one solid bill put together that they can compromise and pass. This, of course, will lead to a drawn-out political fight that I'm sure I will be returning to in the coming days, as people really start freaking out about it. And we can learn which ones of these amendments are actually the most controversial ones. The incentives to pass this with the amendments are definitely there, though, as nobody wants to be the one congressman who goes against America's most famous bumper sticker, support the troops. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. I hope you enjoyed this video. Sorry it was a little bit of a news dump. If you did, subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. I do pay attention to that. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.